Hello everyone, welcome back to Safety Pilot. This is Caleb and Andrew with another mock check ride. Today we're going to be doing a commercial check ride. If you haven't seen our private and instrument check rides and you're still in one of those levels of training, be sure to check them out. We'll put links somewhere probably in the description and maybe up on top in the video. Today I'm going to be the student and Andrew is going to be acting as a designated practical examiner. We've had some questions in previous videos, so I just want to start with a disclaimer here. We are both flight instructors. Neither of us are DPEs, designated practical examiners, which are the people that are designated by the Federal Aviation Administration to give these tests. So we are giving a mock practical test. It is a compendium of our experiences with the commercial check rides, as well as sending students to commercial check rides. So that's kind of where we're getting our information. So our experience with DPEs, talking with DPEs, and then our actual check ride experiences as well. We are not pretending to be DPE. Well, we are pretending to be them, but we are not saying that we are DPEs. So just keep that in mind down in the comments.
All right, great. So whether you're preparing for a commercial check ride or you just want to know what it might be like when you get there, or if you're just interested in aviation, welcome to this video. We're going to get started. Again, our criteria here, our goal is to make it as real as possible in terms of time and in terms of scope. We're not going to stop to explain things, as DPEs are not allowed to teach during the check ride. So if there is an error, I might dig into a little bit farther with the student, and then we will move on. And then in post-editing, we'll put in the correct answers, or we'll discuss it at the end in the debrief. So without further ado, let's begin. All right. So welcome to your check ride. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You're at the commercial level, so you've already done this a time or two.
Yep. Very nervous.
Well, you've proven before that you can do it, and I'm sure today you'll prove just the same. So thank you for bringing the documents. We've looked into your aircraft. You'll be flying Cessna 172. And we looked at the log books. You showed me there the annual, the ELT, and that you have all the documents required for the aircraft to show that it's airworthy. Could you just remind me, what were those documents that you need to have in the aircraft?
Yeah, so in the aircraft, I need to have an airworthiness certificate,
okay.
And I need to have a registration, and I need the operating limitations. So in my case, I have an airplane flying, or a aircraft flight manual, or POH.
Okay.
And then I need the empty weight and balance information, which is also in the POH booklet.
Sure, okay. And what did you say was the, you mentioned that one of those expire. Which one of those expires?
Well, I didn't mention it, but now that you mentioned it, the registration is going to be good for 7 years.
Okay, and so the other ones don't expire?
Correct, they do not expire.
So if I have my 1946 Cessna 140, would my airworthiness still be good that came with the airplane?
As long as the aircraft is kept in airworthy condition and conforms to its type certificate, it will maintain its airworthiness.
Okay. And what's the type certificate?
Type certificate is a thing when an aircraft is made. So when my 172 was made, a type certificate came out with it that basically says these are the things that make the 172 the 172. So the engine type, the RPM ranges, the location of the datum line where you measure weight and balance from, and other information about fuel grade and flap travel and stuff.
Okay. Sort of like the DNA.
Yeah.
The exactly. Birth certificate.
Yep. Okay. So somebody could walk up and look at the type certificate and they would know, okay, that's what a 172 is supposed to have.
Okay. So even if my plane is from the 1940s, I can still fly. My airworthiness certificate is still good as long as it conforms to its type certificate. And safety is what you said.
Yeah. And it's also maintained in airworthy condition. Okay. So the maintenance has to be up to date.
All right. And just short and simple, what is airworthiness?
Airworthiness is conforming to type certificate and safe to fly.
Okay. All right, great. Yeah, thank you. So you've shown me the log books, and as we go out to the plane, you'll double check and you'll show me those documents.
Okay.
I'd appreciate that. What about on your person? And now as a commercial pilot, what are you going to carry?
I'm going to carry my pilot's license. I'm going to carry photo ID. I'm just carrying my driver's license. And I'm going to carry my medical certificate.
Okay. All right. Perfect. And you have all of those with you today?
Yes.
And you have those for every flight?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, not just commercial.
All right. Let's say you're going out now to your flight and you've double checked those documents are in the plane. A nice looking gentleman or lady walks up to you in a nice suit and they show you a badge. And they ask you for you to show the documents. What kind of documents would you expect to show them?
Well, I would expect to show them what I just told you, kind of documents to prove that I'm able to fly this aircraft.
Okay.
So I would show them what they ask for, but I would show them my pilot's license and my driver's license, and my medical certificate.
Okay. And are you required to show them?
If they ask me to see it, yeah.
Okay. And what types of people are you required to show these documents to?
So it could be an FAA representative, or it could even be like an airport person or local law enforcement.
Okay. Yeah, perfect. So if any of these people come up to your local law enforcement or anything, you're gonna show them that you're good to fly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. So we're gonna jump into the scenario that I gave you, but really quickly now, spontaneously, you weren't planning for this. Your friend wants to rent a plane. He learns you're a commercial pilot. He's like, perfect, Caleb's a commercial pilot. And he asks you to fly him to Chicago for work, for his job.
Okay.
And he offers to pay you for your flight time and a little bit extra for your services. Are you good to go? How are you going to make that decision?
Okay, so...
We're looking here at the legal side, not at the weather and flight planning.
So I'm renting an airplane from a flight school or rental?
Your friend will be renting the plane.
Okay.
And he will be hiring you as the pilot.
So I cannot do that because when the airplane is rented from a flight school or something like that, or an aircraft rental area, the operational control of the aircraft is passed to the leaser or the renter of the aircraft, making it called a dry lease.
Okay.
And with that dry lease, since that renter of the aircraft has operational control, they would then need to be, if they're making money on their flight, they would need to be certified in some way, 135 or something like that.
Your friend, you're saying, would have to be certified. Okay.
Yep. So I can't, I'm not willingly going to partake in doing that because I know that aircraft, the operational control of the aircraft is his. And if I rented it, it would be mine. And so I can't then just go start making money doing it without some sort of FAA certification.
Okay. Now, what if he says, you explain all that to him, he understands, he's like, you know what, Caleb, I won't pay you that. Let's go out for a nice dinner afterwards.
Well, I'm only allowed to, I have to pay my pro rata share for this flight.
Okay.
So, I mean, if he's carrying goods in furtherance of a business, even if he's not paying me, I'm still helping him, so I can't do that. But if it's just a leisurely flight, I have to pay up to my pro rata share, and he has to pay the other half of the share. And that's only things like the rental costs and fuel and oil and landing and tie-down fees and stuff.
Okay. So. All right, perfect. You mentioned as well the word operational control. How do you define operational control?
Well, that's a steep thing for me. I'm not very legalized. I'm not a lawyer, but... I would just say operational control is the person that has the ability to decide when the aircraft takes off or stays on the ground.
Okay. All right. Yeah, fine. All right, yeah, so you covered it well. So we talked about your pro rata share, and you'd be operating then under what part?
Part 91.
Part 91, okay. Perfect. You're going to... conduct this flight. So I guess let's say now, under what circumstances in this scenario would you be able to make that flight for hire?
I think the easiest way would be if my friend owned his own airplane, then he could hire me as a pilot to fly for him.
Okay.
It would still be up to him to make sure that he's operating under Part 91 instead of doing something that might be considered a Part 135 operation. And it's my diligence. I should put diligence in as well to make sure that he's not doing anything illegal.
Right. So it's not an illegal charter operation or something. Or
yes.
All right. So let's say your friend does own the aircraft, and you've determined that that he's got everything fine. It's going to be a simple 91 operation. Actually, no, we've already answered that. So these were going into the documents you want to find out. All right. Your friend owns his aircraft, and you're going in now to inspect the aircraft. You're looking for those documents. You find that the registration for the aircraft expired 6 years ago. Can you fly the airplane legally?
Not without a valid registration. So I would apply for the new registration.
Okay.
And these days with the FAA, it's probably going to take a while.
Okay.
And if the aircraft needs to move in the meantime, I would have to get a ferry permit to move it.
Okay. Yeah, and okay. So you probably have the owner apply for continuous registration. How would you go about getting a ferry permit?
I would call the FISDO, and there may be a way online. I've never done it, but I could call the FISDO and request a ferry permit. I know my nearest FISDO is down in Minneapolis,
okay.
So I could find them on the internet and search them up.
Sure, yeah. So find a FISDO and call and get an answer. Perfect. So you're getting in the plane now to fly with your friend. All the documents are clear, the registration's good. You start running up the airplane. You do a run up. And you get an alternator failure warning. Are you still safe to make this flight if the alternator is not working?
In order to determine this, I would need to go through a couple different things for in inoperative equipment.
Okay.
So the first thing in my head is I'm thinking I don't have a minimum equipment list, so I'm going to be going 91213. There's a list of things to go down. So I'm going to consider, is it part of A tomato flames 91205, and an alternator is not in there, except a source of power would be at night, but during the day it's not in there. But then I also would need to look at the kinds of operations list in my POH, okay. And my equipment list in section 6 of my POH, and see if an alternator is listed on there. And my in lieu of looking it up right now, I would believe that it's not okay to take off without it.
Okay.
And I know from a safety standpoint that I definitely would not do it. So even if I looked through those things and found that it was allowable to take off without an alternator, I would not take off without it for safety. And my guess is, I think for the sake of time, just this is kind of a break in the Checkride thing. In the actual Checkride, I would look this up, but for the sake of this video and timing, maybe we'll look it up after the video, but I would say that it probably in section 6 of the POH in the equipment list, it is listed as required equipment.
Okay.
That would be my guess.
All right.
But I'm not going to guess on a Checkride, people. Checkride tip number one.
So let's say that you, so we know, for example, Cirruses have dual alternators, and then their kinds of equipment lists. If you're doing day VFR, you only need one. You can fly without one, at least in the older generations. So you've mentioned from a safety standpoint. So in your Cessna 172, you only have
one alternator,
and you're going to fly without it. You said that you probably wouldn't from a safety perspective. Why not? What is the purpose of the alternator?
Well, the alternator is going to be directly charging my battery, and without an alternator, I will quickly lose my battery. So okay. My battery will be gone in maybe 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes. I've never tested it, and my 172 is a glass cockpit 172,
okay.
So I would lose my primary display, and I would be working on backup instruments.
Okay.
So there, and besides that, I'd be losing flaps. I have electric flaps in my airplane, so I'd also lose flaps. And that's just the things I can think of right now. There
sure.
are probably other things. I'd lose all my lights and everything. So it'd be a very suspect operation,
okay.
Which is why I'm leaning towards, without looking it up, I'm leaning towards thinking that it would be very much not allowed.
Yeah, sure. And let's say in the kinds of equipment list, it says you can fly without the alternator, which you've already said you doubt. Let's say it does say you can fly without the alternator. Could you still choose not to fly with it? Let's say your passenger's really like, he's like, man, he knows the regulations. He's like, Caleb, you can still fly without it. You can still fly without it. Are you still allowed to not make the flight? Because
yeah,
you feel
absolutely. So I'm the pilot in command. So I'm going to make the ultimate decision about
okay.
whether I'm going to fly or not. And in a situation like that where I've already decided it's not safe, I'm going to set that bar. And it doesn't matter what the passengers say, I'm going to stick to it for safety.
Okay. So, yeah, so you're going to set, what you said, a border or an ultimatum, I guess, in your own kind of mindset of, I'm not going to fly if this. So that gives us to minimums. We talk about having minimums. Do you have personal minimums that you use when you fly?
Yep. I have my own personal minimum sheet, and I update it about every 2 to 3 months.
Okay.
So I update it about 4 times per year, kind of rolls, and it has a list for my VFR minimums. And since I'm an instrument-rated pilot, it also has my instrument-rated minimums. And they kind of, my minimums will go up or down based on how much I'm flying.
Okay.
During given
All right. So you'd even raise your minimums?
Yep, of course.
Okay.
Especially with instrument flying, if I don't fly instrument for a while, I'm going to raise my ceilings, raise my number of missed approaches before I go, find another airport or something, just because I'm less confident.
Oh, yeah, I like that. if you wanted to get your minimums lower, what are some of your options?
Maybe the best option would be go to fly with an experienced flight instructor.
Okay.
At a reputable school, or go fly with another pilot that is current and knows their stuff.
Okay. Have you heard of the Wings program?
Yes, I have heard of the Wings program.
Okay. What does the Wings program give you?
Well, the FAA Wings program has opportunities to do recurrent training. They have ground courses, and I think they also have flying courses where you can take a little course and bring it to a flight instructor and go fly with them and do that, and it's good for recurrent training.
Sure, yeah. You can even work on doing your flight review and keeping your minimums low, because it gives you stuff to do to practice, stuff that maybe you wouldn't normally practice. All right. So we've already talked about, if the alternator isn't working, you've decided that it's not safe to fly. Could you fly that to, let's say, 5 miles away, there's another airport for maintenance?
If it's not allowed, I need a ferry permit.
Okay. Yep. And we've already talked about how to get that. All right, so today you've to Des Moines?
Yep.
Yep, so we're going to kind of cut out from the Chicago. We're going to be flying to Des Moines. And what I'd love to dive into right now is your weather briefing.
Okay.
You have that.
So I did my weather briefing in ForeFlight.
Okay.
Is it okay if I just run through that with you in ForeFlight?
Perfect. Yep.
Okay. So I'm going to pull up ForeFlight right now. So my plan flight here is from Duluth International Airport to Duluth International Airport down to Des Moines, Iowa. And I'm just waiting for it to load. Okay, so there's my route, starting out with Duluth. I'm going to pull up the flight information and then go to my weather briefing.
All right, what kind of briefings can you do, say, with the flight service?
Well, there are a couple different ways to get weather briefings. I am a big fan of calling 1-800-WX-BRIEF. They will, if I call them and I give them a list of about, I think, 8 things or so, they will kind of go through and they'll interpret all these charts for me, and they are meteorologists that are, I believe, employed by the FAA, or maybe some third-party company, and they know their stuff better than I know it, so it's really helpful to have their descriptions with a lot of this stuff. I could also go online to WX Brief, 1-800-WX-BRIEF. I don't know, it's wxbrief.com or .weather, I don't know what it is. But I can find that pretty easily, and you can get a graphical briefing very much like ForeFlight, or I can use this ForeFlight one here. When I'm calling a briefer, I can request either an Outlook, standard, or abbreviated. Outlook if it's more than 6 hours away. Standard if it's between maybe 2 to 6 hours, or really any time when I haven't gotten a full briefing, I can call and request one. And then an abbreviated briefing would be maybe I forgot what the winds aloft were or the NOTAMs, and I wanted just one or two things. That's what I could use abbreviated for.
Okay.
So I've
for purpose of this flight.
I'm using ForeFlight because it's easy to show, and it's what I prefer to use as a commercial pilot or as a would-be commercial pilot.
And where's ForeFlight getting its?
It's getting everything from the National Weather Service.
Okay.
So it's using the same weather approved weather data as the other sources that I just listed. So it's an approved weather sourcing for weather briefing. It includes all the weather requirements that we need to look. All
right, perfect. Let's jump into it then.
Yeah, okay, cool. So the first thing here is we've got a NOTAMs for this runway 0523 is closed. Then we have instrument weather. So this is an IFR AirMet. There's this orangish yellow color here. That means it's active near the passing time. There's one during our passing time. That's the red one here. And we can see that it's east of us, kind of over southern Lake Superior. That's not in our zone, so I'm not as worried about it, but I know that weather forecasts can expand, and so there is a possibility that could move west. I do know at the bare minimum that if I'm going on a VFR flight, that to my east there will be IFR conditions, okay, or expected IFR conditions. So that's something to think about in case I end up in a problem.
So
east is maybe the best direction to go.
What are these AirMets showing you?
This is showing me, so this is a graphical range, this red zone. It's a graphical range of where the instrument conditions are expected to occur. Perfect. So yep. Ceilings below 1,000 feet and visibility below 3 miles. We've got some turbulence AirMets. These are just south of the flight range. They're beginning at 15,000 feet. So I'm not concerned about them.
Okay.
I'll be flying at 8,500 feet on this flight.
turbulence, high air mats. These are, again, even higher. So actually, these are the same ones. So still going to be up. They're going to be up higher, and they shouldn't be affecting us on the flight. Here is a service analysis chart. So I'm zooming in kind of here. We're going from about that southwest corner of Lake Superior down towards east central Iowa. And I can see that there are no fronts. These blue triangulated lines and the red ones with the semicircles on them, those are fronts. We don't have any of those around. We have some wavy lines, isobars, areas of constant pressure. It looks like we'll be kind of moving along down with them.
Okay, what can those lines of constant pressure show us?
Well, the closer that they are together, for example, in the northwest of the United States, right around here, they look really close together. The windier it's going to be, it's a gradient of pressure, and that wind is going to blow down the pressure gradient.
Okay.
So I'm expecting kind of around here, we're kind of moving around in an area where they're not super close together. They're also not super far apart. It looks like as we go farther south into Iowa, they get a little bit closer. So it might be a little bit windier, but from this, it's hard to say exactly. A winds aloft forecast would be better for looking at that, I think.
Okay. What about these blue H's?
The blue H's are high pressure systems. So they're going to be clockwise rotating, pushing the air out and away, and generally more favorable weather as compared to the lows, which are the exact opposite, raising air and rotating counterclockwise.
Okay. So we have these frontal lines. Let's look at this one down over the Gulf of Mexico. Which way is that? Which way is it moving?
It's going to be moving. Predominantly, our air systems over the United States move west to east with the jet stream, or below the jet stream. And this is also going to be rotating counterclockwise. So the below around that L down there. So these.
Would the L be the outer part or the inner part of the swirl?
The L is the center of the swirl. Okay. So this is swirling, and I know people looking at my fingers here. It's going to swirl counterclockwise around this L right here.
Okay. We have a front over here that has both red and blue. What could that be telling us?
That is a stationary front. So a cold front and a warm front have collided with each other, and they're kind of pushing against each other like this. So it's not going to be moving very quickly. That cold front is kind of like a bulldozer, I imagine it, and that warm front is going to rise up over the cold front. And they're both going in the same direction, so they're going to be kind of pushing against each other, which means it's going to slow down. So that weather will probably last a little bit longer. And that cold front provides lifting force, and that warm front is moving, so it's ready to lift up. So that warm air is going to get pretty high, and it's going to be dropping its moisture. Mm-hmm. Since it's over the ocean, too, it's probably going to be more moist air. So around that area, I would expect to see precipitation. Sure. And in fact, it looks like we can see precipitation on the map.
All right. So we see some numbers here. I see 1,039, 1,030. What are those numbers?
Those are pressures in millibar, I believe.
Okay. And we see the H's and the L's. What are those based on? So what would be the deciding number if we're high or low pressure? If we're above what number are we high?
That is a good question. I've never thought of that before.
Okay.
I kind of thought it was relative.
We talk about a standard day.
Uh-huh.
What's our standard day pressure?
Well, it's 29.92 inches of mercury. Okay. And I thought it was like 1,013 millibar at sea level.
Yep. But
I'm seeing only higher on here.
Sure. So if we're above a standard day, we might expect to see high pressure.
Right. Yep.
All right. So if in northern Iowa we have a high pressure system, and where you're flying north to south through northern Iowa, a high pressure system, would you want to fly to the east of it or to the west of it?
I don't think about this. I think I want to fly to the east of it because I'm going to get tailwinds.
Sure. All right. Yeah, I think that's a great idea. So thinking about the direction of rotation, you can predict winds of the thing. All right, so last thing we have here, we have those orange dashed lines.
Those are troughs. They are areas of constant low pressure. And low pressure tends to cause cloud formation, rising air. So they're areas where we might expect to see clouds.
Okay. And we have quite the stationary front there, don't we?
Yeah.
Over the Rockies, I think.
Yep.
All right, perfect. All right, so we can continue on in the briefing.
Okay. METARs, got some. So this right now is at 8:45 a.m. and our planned flight leaves at noon. So these METARs are helpful, but they're not current for, or they're not up to date for when our flight's actually going to happen. So we can see here, ForeFlight gives it to us color coded. There are some green VFR and then blue marginal along our route right now, and then we expect that it will change whether for worse or better is. Okay. To be determined by TAFs.
Can you just read across this first METAR up here on the top?
Yep, so this is a VFR at Kilo Charlie Oscar Quebec. That's Cloquet Airport on December or January 19th at 1335 Zulu. So we're 6 hours behind that. So 13 minus 6 is 7. So this is at 7:35 a.m. This METAR was, again, at Cloquet, so I'm just decoding that again. It's automatic, which means that there was no human being to correct it or look at, check any of it over. The winds were 320, so 320 degrees at 5 knots, 10 statute miles of visibility. Skies were clear, below 12,000 it's clear, and maybe above, but it can't report that high. Minus 23 degrees Celsius, minus 26 degrees is the dew point. The altimeter setting is 3030, so that's high pressure. And then remarks, it's A02, which means that it can report different types of precipitation. And thunderstorms are not, I don't know what NO stands for, but it means that it can't detect thunderstorms. Okay. Not operational, not, I don't know what it stands for.
Great. Great. So we see a temperature dew point spread.
Yep.
What is that? What can that tell us?
Well, when the temperature starts to cool towards the dew point and within 3 degrees or so, and the closer it gets, the worse it gets, we'll start to see visible moisture in the air as the moisture condenses out of the air because it can't hold it anymore. So we might see fog, we might see some light haze, or we might see full-blown low stratus clouds or something like that.
Okay. All right. So one of the things we often talk about when we talk about the dew point spread, we talk about humidity. What is relative humidity?
Well, relative humidity is the amount of moisture in the air compared to how much moisture the air could hold at its given temperature.
All right, and that's expressed as?
It's expressed as a percent.
Okay.
Yep.
So if let's say the temperature outside is 90 degrees
mm-hmm.
as in compared to 50 degrees. So we have one day where it's 90 degrees, one day where it's 50 degrees. We have 50% relative humidity on both days. Which day is there actually more water vapor in the air?
All right. 90 degrees has 50% of what it could hold. Well, I believe that as temperature increases, the amount of water that can be held, that can be suspended in the air increases. So I believe the 90 degree one.
Think so?
Well, it feels like a bit of a trick question to me. At the 50 degree temperature day, 50%.
I liked your answer.
I like 90 degrees, and now I know why. Because at 90 degrees, objectively at 90 degrees, all else being the same, the atmosphere can hold more moisture because it's warmer.
Sure.
And if it's 50% relative humidity, it's holding half of what it could hold. Yeah. So which is going to be more, because if the total is higher than half of each, it's going to be higher still.
So in these days here when we're getting temperatures that are pretty cold, negative 10.
The air gets dry.
Negative 20. 50% relative humidity isn't a lot of water at all, actually.
No.
Whereas in 90 degree weather, 50% or 60, 70% humidity might feel like you're walking through water. You know?
So everyone starts looking for their chapstick in winter up here.
Yeah. All right. So we see that relative humidity is really relative, which is why we might use the temperature dew point spread. All right, we can continue on with your briefing there. You've gone through METARs.
Okay. Pilot reports. This is, again, the same kind of thing where these
are... Just tell me about this. Who makes them?
The pilots make them. Report them to ATC or...
Okay. How long do they last?
Until ATC takes them down.
Yeah, probably. It's usually about at least an hour.
Okay.
All right. But there isn't, you know, really any set deadline. Like I said, around the hour point, but obviously if a lot of planes are making the same pyre up. We can go on. Would pyre ups be considered current weather or forecasted weather?
Current weather.
Current weather. Sure. What other kind of current weather do we have?
METARs.
METARs. Anything else?
Is a center weather advisory current weather? I believe it is.
Yeah, so the main ones we have are METAR and PIRAP.
Yeah.
Really, everything else is forecast for the most part. All right, we can continue on.
Okay, cloud coverage. So this is at
we do have surface observation charts.
Yep. Yeah. So this is at 9 a.m., noon, 3 p.m., and we can kind of see how the cloud cover gets more and more as it's going. Yeah. I also need to look at the central area because I'm going down into central. All
right. We're good with that. We can move on from that.
Okay. Now we got the same kind of graphs, but in this case we're showing precipitation and percentages and air met. So there's that same air met, the IFR air met. This is showing these are snow showers, the triangle with the star. Okay.
Where would you go if you wanted to figure out these symbols? Because these charts can have quite a few different symbols, and I'm sure.
So these are National Weather Service symbols.
Okay.
So you could check with the National Weather Service; they might have a chart. You could also just Google National Weather Service symbol charts, or symbols, and you could find them.
All right. All right, we can go on from that. What I'm really
I know that because I've done it before.
Have we already been through your TAFs? I really want to get to your TAFs.
Nope, TAFs are next. Here's the terminal aerodrome forecast. So we can see now here during our travel time what the expected weather conditions are.
Okay. All right, perfect. So I want you to decode one of these. Let's just go for the top one again.
Okay. So
just the top two lines.
Okay. So the Duluth TAF, it's again January 19th at 11:21 Zulu. That was the time when the TAF was made. And then the TAF reporting period is from January 19th at 12 Zulu until the 20th at 12 Zulu. So this is a 24-hour TAF, so it only forecasts 24 hours in the future. During that TAF period, initial conditions are expected to be 330 at 7 knots, 6 statute miles, light snow showers, that's what the minus is there, and then broken clouds at 4,500. There's a temporary condition, which means it lasts for a shorter amount of time. From the beginning of the TAF period at 12 Zulu, which is 6 a.m. today, until 16 Zulu, which is 10 a.m. So it's a 4-hour period. It's going to be 1.5 statute mile visibility, light snow, and broken clouds at 2,500. And then from there, the conditions are going to change and improve.
All right, so we see their IFR. One of them is showing IFR. What are the conditions for instrument flight rules?
It needs to be visibility less than 3 miles and or ceilings less than 1,000 feet.
Or less. Okay. Yep. All right. And you said you do have your instrument rating.
I do have my instrument rating. Okay. I would still, I'm not going to say it.
Sure. That's good for your weather. As you're flying along, you start to develop engine roughness. What are you going to do?
Well, I have a checklist for it. My first thinking would be it could be something fuel related. It's one of the number one causes in engine failures. So change the fuel tank, mixture full rich. Those would probably be the first things I do, and maybe add carb heat as well. Except I'm fuel injected, so I'm not going to add carb heat, so I don't have carb rated heat.
And you don't have a fuel pump?
I do have a fuel pump, but it's for starting only. Because I have a gravity feed system.
Okay.
And then I have a checklist, and I would start troubleshooting using my checklist, and I would also be immediately thinking, where can I land?
Okay.
In case it gets worse.
Yeah. All right. So we talked about some IFR air mets there.
Mm-hmm.
What considerations would you take into account flying into clouds at this time of year? We're in the winter in northern Minnesota.
Icing is a huge concern in the winter. Even when it's not forecast, it can be there. It often is. So I'm not certified for flight into known icing. My aircraft is not. And so I need to be very careful flying into clouds. My policy is generally to avoid prolonged flight in clouds. And if there's an air met or a PIREPS for icing, then not at all. But if it doesn't seem like there's icing, then I'm okay to punch through small layers if I know that they're small layers. But in this case, it's prolonged IFR conditions along the entire route, so I'm not going to fly.
Okay. What are the different types of icing?
There is rime icing, clear icing, and then a mixture of the two, mixed icing.
And what's the difference between rime and clear ice?
Rime icing is usually formed when the temperatures are really cold and when there are smaller moisture droplets in the air, and they freeze immediately on contact. They trap little air bubbles when they freeze because they freeze so fast. And so it's bumpy, and it looks kind of clear or milky-ish because you can see the air bubbles distort the color. And then clear ice would be when droplets take longer to freeze, it's warmer conditions, maybe just below freezing, and they spread out along the surface that they hit, and they freeze in a clear layer that's hard to see.
Which one of those would you say is the worst? It's the most dangerous?
I would say that, because I've been told clear ice is worse, it's harder to see, it weighs more, it comes about more suddenly, and it's associated with large supercooled liquid droplets, SLDs, and they can accumulate really quickly.
Okay.
So.
Yeah. I think the FAA there would agree with you. Clear. All right. So what are some of the symptoms of icing? Where are you going to look to determine if you have icing?
Well, so in most aircraft, you probably get carburetor, or sorry, for carbureted aircraft, you might get carburetor icing first, and that would be engine roughness, decrease in engine RPM.
What types of carburetor icing are there?
There's ram icing, which is where it just collects in the inlet to the carburetor. And there can also be fuel evaporation. When the fuel evaporates, it absorbs all the heat and the area around it, like the throat of the carburetor cools down and ice can form on the throat of the carburetor. And then just upstream of the throttle valve, the pressure is lower, and so the ice will form sooner there as well.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, so you talked about carburetor icing. And what kind of problems would that develop in your engine?
Well, eventually it's going to decrease the amount of airflow that gets into the engine, so it's going to, your power will go down, and eventually it can clog the entire carburetor and you get no power into the engine and your engine will quit.
Okay. So you said now you are fuel injected.
Correct.
What do you have to worry about in terms of induction ice for fuel injected engine?
Induction icing.
Okay.
I have to worry about. So my air induction on my aircraft, there is a filter on the front just below the propeller, and that can get clogged with ice. And if that gets clogged with ice, the normal path of air through the filter into the, you know, carburetor, or not the carburetor, but into the air box and the engine would get clogged. So my aircraft has an alternate air door, and it's not pilot controlled, it's automatic.
Okay.
So if my air intake gets clogged, the suction of the engine pulling air in will open that air door and air will go in through my air box instead.
All right. So even if you're fuel injected, you don't have a carburetor, induction icing could still be a problem.
Yeah, yep. But instead of happening near the carburetor, it might happen near the filter, which could happen even in a carbureted engine.
Okay.
And that's why we have alternate air.
All right. You're coming into landing. You drop. You lower some a degree of flaps, and your nose drops.
That sounds like a tailplane stall.
Okay. Explain to me a tailplane stall.
So the ice is more likely to accumulate on surfaces with more surface area, smaller surfaces. So the horizontal stabilizer of my aircraft is potentially more likely to accumulate ice than my front wings are. So if I build up ice on there, then the airflow over it will be disrupted. It'll be premature separation. I won't be making as much lift. I'll be getting a lot of extra drag. So then if I add flaps, the airflow profile over my horizontal stabilizer will change. It'll change the angle of attack. And if it increases, it'll increase that angle of attack over the horizontal stabilizer. And if I already have premature separation or disrupted airflow over the horizontal stabilizer, it can just, it can stall.
So how would you recover?
So if that stall happens, recovers, then I need to pull up to break the stall instead of pushing down to break the stall.
Okay. What about your flaps?
I would immediately go back up to the flap setting I was at before.
Go back, return to the flap setting and pull the nose up to lower angle of attack on the horizontal. All right, so one last question here about weather before we move on. You're sitting on the ground with your friend. There's been a light snowfall, and you notice that the horizontal stabilizer has a little bit of a dusting of snow, a little bit of snow on it. And your friend's like, come on, hurry up, let's go. Do you need to do anything about that snow, or are you going to take off with some snow on your airplane?
I should have no snow or frost or ice on my airplane when I take off.
Okay.
So I can take it off with a broom or wipe it off with my hand.
Even if it's a tiny little light dusting?
I would still take it off.
What problems could that cause?
Well, it could freeze under the aircraft because it gets colder when I get higher. So if it doesn't get blown off by the prop wash or during takeoff roll, it could freeze on. And then even on takeoff roll, if it's still on there, it could increase the drag on my airplane during takeoff roll and affect the airflow over the airplane. So
Zero tolerance is a zero tolerance policy for...
Correct.
For ice, frost, and snow. Okay. All right. Okay, so we're going to jump into your route now.
Okay.
down to Des Moines. Explain to me how you chose your route and altitude.
Okay, so first of all, I did this on my paper charts, okay. And I also did it on 4Flight. I did it the old-fashioned way, but I'm going to show it on here because it's easier to show.
Okay.
But I checked with my examiner beforehand and made sure that it was okay to use 4Flight. But I showed up to my Checkride with both to show my examiner that I can do both. So I planned a flight here from Duluth International Airport to Des Moines, as I said before. I have picked points along my route and labeled them. These are going to be my pilotage and dead reckoning points. So I'm going to fly to each point along my route to Des Moines.
Okay. And what altitude you chose?
I chose 8,500 feet.
Why did you choose that altitude?
I want to be high. The 8,000 feet range is pretty good for performance for a Cessna 172. It's like the sweet spot range. And then I'm flying west, so I'm going to do an even 1,000 plus 500 feet because I'm VFR. And I also have a 10-knot tailwind on this flight, so that's pretty good. It's about 10 knots at all the altitudes, but...
Would the temperature right now, I mean, it was, you know, negative 10 degrees, would that influence at all your choice of altitude?
For sure. The obvious thing I can think is that for icing conditions, I might choose to fly in warmer weather to stay out of the icing, or on a day like this when it's just super, super cold, well below, I mean, we're negative 22 Celsius, flying higher, the air might even be drier.
Okay.
But...
what about in terms of engine performance?
Well, colder air is denser, and that increases my performance. I didn't specifically take that into consideration here, but perhaps I could have. On my performance charts, when I'm choosing my true airspeed and stuff and calculating fuel flow, there's a provision for air being colder than standard.
Okay.
And so that tends to increase my performance and decrease my fuel flow. So, sure.
So let's say you're flying at 8,000 feet. On a day like today, negative 10 degrees, what might be the density altitude? Just rough. Would it be higher than 8,000 or lower than 8,000?
The density altitude would be lower than 8,000 feet.
Okay, yeah. So on a cold day, you could
probably... It's going to feel like I'm a lot lower.
So you could fly even higher on a cold day for better performance.
Yep.
Okay. On a hot day, obviously, if you go high, you'll get less...
Less performance.
Less power. All right. You mentioned once before NOTAMs. What I want to know about NOTAMs is where do you go to find them? And when do you look at them?
I go to 4Flight.
Okay. And show me where you find them on 4Flight.
I'm going to go to my flight, and I'm going to go all the way to the end of my briefing, and here's departure NOTAMs.
Okay.
And destination.
Yeah.
And
so you show this to me. Is there another place you can go if I just want to find out, for example, if an airport is closed or if they have a runway closed?
Yeah, so I can click on Des Moines, for example, and NOTAMs is over here on the right, and I can see their NOTAMs. I can even see their older NOTAMs if I go farther down.
All right, so when do you check NOTAMs?
I check NOTAMs before I take off on my flight. It's one of the things I do in my pre-flight briefing. I do a part of every weather briefing. And if I call 1-800-WX-BRIEF, they would also give me NOTAMs.
Okay. So that's something you do before every flight?
Before every flight.
Okay. All right. So looking at your flight here then, what's your time estimated time en route?
I think just over 2.5 hours. 2 hours and 47 minutes.
Okay. And your fuel burn?
Fuel burn, I'm burning 8.6 gallons per hour in cruise. That's what I calculated from my performance charts before I arrived here.
Open up here to Des Moines. And you've already said that because of certain conditions, you will not be making this flight.
Correct.
And that was
because of the predominant marginal VFR conditions. Low, very low ceilings, and that low ceiling layer goes up to like 16,000 feet. Okay. So I know I can't get above it.
Let's say you're right there at your point that says Iowa Falls.
Okay.
And you start having some engine roughness.
Okay.
Like you mentioned before. You go through your checklist. You can't get it fixed. Your oil pressure is still showing that it's fine. Maybe it's icing. You're not sure. Maybe you have induction icing, and you decide that you want to divert, but because of IFR conditions, instrument conditions, this area around here is all, let's say, low IFR for conditions of you can't land there.
Oh boy, sounds like I'm in a pickle.
You're in a bit of a pickle. So I want you to see if you can divert over here. I believe it's Cedar Rapids, the Eastern Iowa to Eastern Iowa Airport from Iowa Falls. I want to see you just to see if you can make it there and how much fuel you would burn in that diversion.
Okay. So there are a couple different ways that I could do this. I'm going to use ForeFlight to do this. So I'm going to clear out my old route, which I have saved. I'm going to go from Iowa Falls. Oops. To
CID.
To, looks like Cedar Rapids Airport. Okay, so I'm going to divert here. And it's 76 miles.
Okay.
And I am cruising at a 115 knots. So I'm going to use, since ForeFlight's not pulling it up, there, I just got it now. Save me there. So I was about to pull this out, and I could do this as well and use my thing right here and calculate the time and route and the fuel. But the according to ForeFlight, it can take me 41 minutes, and it's going to burn 7.1 gallons of fuel.
Okay. And how much would you have burned flying to Iowa Falls?
From my yeah. initial spot to Iowa Falls.
I want you to see that you know you can make it and how much fuel you have
sure.
remaining.
Okay. Well, let me open my computer just so I can write some numbers down. Pulling my nav log and I'm looking at the fuel burn. By the time I get to Iowa Falls, I will have burned 20.3 gallons. And then it's going to take me 7.1 gallons from Iowa Falls to Cedar Rapids, which is about, it's 27.4 gallons.
Okay, and how many gallons do you have when you take off?
I'm taking off with, just you and me in the airplane, we can hold 56 usable gallons, okay. 58 total gallons. So we will have burned just under half of our fuel.
Okay.
And so we should be able to make it.
So you still have plenty of fuel.
Yep. By the time we get to Cedar Rapids, we'll only be about half tank.
All right. Now, if you were going to fly that exact route back, would you be able to make it? You said you flew under half, so you should have enough fuel. Is that
well, so this is bare minimum. This isn't counting the FAA's requirement for extra
okay.
fuel, and it's not counting my own personal minimums.
Right. What are your own personal?
My own personal is 1 hour of reserve fuel, so that's going to be an extra 8.6 gallons of fuel because
okay.
cruise fuel for 1 hour is 8.6 gallons.
And what is the FAA?
They want 30 minutes of extra fuel during
okay.
the day.
All right. All right. Thank you. So if you've decided you could divert there if you needed to. And so you made that calculation. How would you file a flight plan, and when would you choose to do so?
So, thinking in VFR conditions, I can file a VFR flight plan by calling 1-800-WX-BRIEF, and I can put it on file with them there. There's a list of about 14 things, including my destination, if I'm going VFR or IFR, my end number, that kind
yeah,
of stuff.
That's good. So you can go to you can call WX-BRIEF.
Yep. I can also do it in ForeFlight.
Okay.
And I can do it with a flight service station on the ground or in the air.
Okay. All right. And when would you file a flight plan?
Well, I'd file a VFR flight plan. To be honest, I'm not a huge fan of doing it, but I would do it whenever I'm going somewhere outside of radar service.
Okay.
That way, if there's an emergency, they'll start looking for me 30 minutes after my ETA if I haven't closed it.
Okay. All right. So for this flight, where are you going to be filing a flight plan?
Nope. I'm going to be using... I will not be following a VFR flight plan, but I will be using flight following.
Okay. All right. So just east here of Eau Claire, let's say we're at 1,500 feet, somewhere around there. Okay. 1,500 feet. What's the airspace?
Is that 1,500 feet above the ground?
Let's say no MSL.
Above okay.
mean sea level.
So I'm about 400 feet above the ground. I am in class golf airspace.
So you're about 400 feet above the ground?
Yeah.
How did you determine that?
Well, the ground level here looks like it's about 1,100 feet. And you said I'm 1,500 feet.
Okay.
So I'm about 400 feet above the ground.
And how did you determine that the ground is 1,100 feet?
Right here next to the spot, there is a tower of some sort, and its MSL height is 1,385. And in parentheses below it, its AGL height is 231 feet.
Okay.
So if I subtract those, that's the elevation of the ground.
All right. So let's say you go up now to 2,500 feet MSL. What airspace are you in?
Okay, so 1,500 feet was 400, so this is going to be at 1,400 feet, so now I'm in class echo airspace.
Okay, and where is that echo? What's the bottom of the echo airspace?
It's at 1,200 feet. It goes from Gulf to echo.
Okay. Is that all the time?
No, not all the time.
Right. What about in here?
In there, it's going to go at 700 AGL.
Okay, so if you were flying at 2,500 feet, you'd be...
Yeah, figure out what ground level is first. Ground level is about... I'm going to say ground level is 1,200 feet. That's okay. And it looks like it's around 1,000 here. So it does vary even in that small... In this small distance right here, it varies about 200 feet.
Okay. Let's give it just...
let's just say ground level is 1,000 feet up at this northern spot. If ground level is 1,000 feet and you said I'm 2,500 feet...
Correct.
So I'm 1,500 feet above the ground. So I am in class echo airspace. Oh, I didn't realize... Sorry. We are in a class delta. I didn't see that. So this blue ring going around here is a class delta ring.
Yeah, I like that you still explain the echo so I don't have to ask it again.
So we are, so we'd be in delta from the ground all the way up to 3,500 MSL.
Okay. Is that inclusive, 3,500?
Or, say what?
Is that 3,500 inclusive, or if I'm flying right at 3,500, am I out of the delta?
I don't know.
All right, so we'll maybe look at dashed boxes versus solid boxes for our altitude. All right. Just a couple things here. What is the fact that we have a blue circle with the imprint of the runway on it mean?
So it's a blue solid circle, which means it's a paved runway and it's a class delta.
Okay. And the star on top means?
Star on top means it has a rotating beacon light.
Okay, and those little protrudences?
That means that it has fuel pilot services.
And as this airport is compared to MSP, where you have just the outline of the runways, what's the difference?
Okay, so we're comparing this with a circle to... an airport like this one where it's not a circle.
Correct.
Which is a big runway. So this has to do with runway length.
Okay.
I'm going to pull up the legend because
I don't need the exact numbers right now. Just
okay. It's like 8,600 or something. 8,609 feet. So the runway length at that airport we were looking at previously is less. The runways are less than 8,600,
okay,
whatever the number is. And on this one, they're larger. And I can find that in the legend. So I'm going to go to the documents tab, and I made a commercial flight thing, and part of my commercial thing I have the VFR chart legend, and then I can go
perfect.
Up here.
Okay.
8,069 feet.
Yeah. All right, that's good. All right. What is a TFR?
TFR is a temporary flight restriction.
Okay.
Temporary.
What in general? What is it?
So it's basically a no fly zone, created for various reasons. Could be sporting.
Could
or
you ever fly
security.
Into a TFR?
Only if you have permission to fly into the TFR.
Who gives the permission?
Whoever the operating authority is, generally the FAA.
Okay. Not the nearest military base?
No.
All right, what are some other types of special use airports?
Airspace,
yeah.
We have military operation areas and alert areas, restricted areas, prohibited areas, warning areas, controlled firing areas. National security areas.
Explain to me a controlled firing area.
Controlled firing area is an area where the military, I believe it's the military, is doing some sort of controlled firing, and they don't put it on charts because they have scanners, and if they see an aircraft coming, they will cease operation.
Okay.
So that it's we don't have to navigate around them,
right.
But they exist.
Okay. All right. So if let's say you're flying in your class Echo for most of your ride. What are your cloud clearances?
Class Echo cloud clearances is I have to have at least 3 statute miles of visibility, and I need to be 1,000 feet above any clouds, 500 feet below, and 2,000 feet away horizontally.
Okay. What if you fly IFR?
If I fly IFR, I just need to be on an IFR clearance, and I can be in the clouds if I want.
Okay. All right. We're gonna jump down to weight and balance.
Okay. So I planned, you told me to do you and me, and I added 15 pounds in the back for our baggage here. So I weigh 165, you weigh 170.
We're also going to add in now a 60-pound dog.
Okay.
And I want you to choose where in your aircraft you're going to put that, and explain to me why you chose to put it where you put it.
Okay. And you're okay sitting in any seat?
I'm okay sitting in any seat.
Well, I want to sit by the dog.
It's all up to you. You're the pilot in command.
Okay. As much as I would want to sit by the dog is going to be a distraction up front, and I don't want it near the controls, so I'm going to put the dog in the back seat. I've never really considered putting it in the baggage compartment, but my baggage compartment limit is 200 pounds, so it could go back there, but I don't want it near the back. Even if it would... it would increase my performance because it would move my center of gravity farther back. So I would be moving a little bit faster, but I would rather have it somewhere where it could be reached by you in the event that it needs to be dealt with. So in this case here, we are still within limits.
Where did you put me and where did you put the
dog? So I'm in the left seat, you're in the right seat, we're up front, and the dog is in the seat behind us.
Okay. And are we within weight and balance there?
60-pound dog is a pretty big dog. Yeah, so our weight and balance is good. I mean, a dog like that, I might want to be put in a crate, and I don't think a crate's going to fit in the back seat of a 172.
Okay.
So I might have the dog stay.
Okay, not take the dog.
Yeah.
And what's the reasoning for that?
Just the dog can be unruly. It's a big dog, and if it tries to jump up into the front of the airplane or something like that, it's not going to be.
Well, I'm your passenger. I'm paying you. I really want my dog. It's my
airplane.
I'm going
to say
it's my
not...
dog.
I'm going to say I really hope you can get to destination, but I don't think it's going to be good for the safety of you or your dog.
What if we have a little 5-pound dog?
That's different. Okay. We could put that in like a kennel and put it on the back seat. We could even strap the seat in.
So you would really want to have an animal in a cage?
Yeah, somewhere that's controlled. And it depends. It depends on the animal. There's nothing wrong with that. It depends on the animal. I know that there are organizations like Pilots and Paws that do really good things, and people put dogs in all different kinds of configurations. Right. I've never done it, and so especially in a for hire flight with somebody like this, I don't want to add any extra risk. All
right, so let's say we show up. What's your gross weight?
The max gross weight is 2,500 pounds.
2,500. What's your empty weight?
My empty weight.
Prefer like your payload. What's after fuel? Your max payload.
My empty weight is basically 2,100 pounds, 2,088 pounds, and I can go up to 2,500. So I've got about 400.
You have a useful 400.
Sorry, zero fuel weight. You want it emptied? So I just take my zero fuel weight.
All right, let me just paint you the situation here, just for the sake of time. Your max gross weight is 2,500 pounds.
It's actually 2,450.
2,450. Let's say you show up to fly. I told you it was just me. You put in full fuel. Now let's say you're up at 2,000 pounds. So you have 450 pounds of useful load. And I show up and I bring along two friends with me.
Mm-hmm.
And we all tell you our weights. And we have some baggage. We tell you our baggage. And you calculate it all out based on what we told you to be right at 2,450 pounds. Maybe just a tad under. Are we good to fly? How are you going to feel as a PIC?
If we're under the max weight, we can fly. If we're over, we cannot. And even if we're at 2,450, if that's where we're at and we feel good about the weights that we're given out, I do feel confident to fly that. I know that it will affect my flying performance, takeoff performance, and climb performance.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would I'd want to recalculate my takeoff and landing distances.
Mm-hmm.
And that might affect whether we can land or take off on certain runways. And then a climb out is going to be worse performance. So
okay, so you're just going to take longer to take off, longer to land. Would you ever consider weighing bags or passengers?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
If they're up near that limit and those weights were kind of just estimates, yeah, I would consider weighing.
Better. So a lot of people don't know how much they actually weigh or how much their bags weigh. All right. All right, so jumping into your plane now, walk me through how your fuel gets from A to B.
Okay,
where does your fuel start? Where does it end?
So I have a gravity-fed fuel system. So there are two wing tanks in my airplane, and they both feed into a shared tank. And then from that tank, they go through a series of filters. They go to a fuel selector valve. And actually, they go from the wing tanks to secondary tanks inside the airplane. Then they go to a fuel selector. Then they go to a shared tank, a reservoir tank.
Okay.
Because that my fuel selector can go between the left tank, the right tank, or both tanks. So I've got a fuel selector valve. I've got a couple different filters and sumps, and then a fuel pump. And then it goes. All of it then goes down to a spider or a fuel distributor, where it then sends it to the various injectors where the fuel isn't injected. I also have a fuel control unit, which takes in both the fuel and the air, and it meters the fuel based on the amount of airflow going through the fuel control unit.
Okay. Do you have, in terms of switching fuel tanks, do you have left and right tanks, or do you have a both?
I have a both.
Okay.
I also have left and right.
Okay. So during normal operations, are you on left or
right? I run it on both.
Okay.
I run it on both.
All right. What about oil? How much oil do you have?
I have an eight quart oil sump, and we run it usually around 6 quarts, so just a little bit under.
And what are the purposes of oil in your engine?
The oil cools the engine because it's colder than the engine parts. It lubricates the parts. It provides shock absorption between the metal parts. It also cleans the oil or cleans the engine parts. If there's any rubbing, it cleans out all the debris and stuff.
Okay. So let's say as you're flying along that you experienced low oil pressure with, let's say, no change in oil temperature. What are you going to do?
Well, I would expect, if it was a real oil pressure emergency, I would expect the oil temperature to rise very quickly, because when there's less and less of it, I would expect the temperature to go up. But that could also be just a failure of the system. For example, the oil port, an oil connector line could have just broken off in the engine, and we could be spewing oil. So when my oil pressure indicator goes down, I will immediately consider it to be an emergency and find somewhere to land. And I will deal with whether it was a faulty gauge or an actual imminent emergency when I'm on the ground.
Okay. And is that an emergency where you're getting to the ground immediately, putting it into a field, or that you're looking for the nearest airport?
No, I'm just looking for the nearest place to land. And I'm expecting my engine to fail, so I'm prepared to shut my engine off, because I don't want to keep running it if I keep running my engine when it has no oil in it, it could destroy the engine and it could start a fire.
Okay.
So I'm being ready to pull the mixture and shut off the fuel and that kind of stuff.
All right. We're talking about your right wing now. The sump is stuck up.
Yep.
You can see it's dribbling out fuel and it's spraying back across the wing. What's your immediate course of action?
I'm going to run on the opposite tank. I mean, this is kind of depending on how much fuel I have in the other tank, but I'm going to run on the opposite tank, and I'm also going to get on the ground.
Okay. And is this a land in a field or land in the nearest airport?
This is the nearest airport. I mean, again, it depends on how much fuel
absolutely.
I have in the other tank. But if I know I have no fuel in the other tank, or if it's both that are leaking or something, then that's going to be... I'm still going to try to get as far as I can or find the best place I can to land. But if I can calculate that I have room to land at an airport, I'll go to an airport.
All right. What are your secondary flight controls?
Trim, flaps... That's what I have, trim
okay.
and flaps.
And you said your flaps are electric. What about your trim?
The trim is manually controlled trim, elevator trim. I also have ground adjustable trim on the rudder.
Okay. All right. So now that you're a commercial pilot, you're going to be flying high and fast, right?
Okay.
Potentially. So some of the factors we talk about, physiological and human factors, are really important to consider as you're going to be doing some new things. So one of the things we talk about in altitude is hypoxia. So we have different types of hypoxia. I don't need you to tell me the different types. I want you to just talk about what are the dangers of hypoxia, what are some of the symptoms, and how do you counteract that?
Okay. So hypoxia is just, it's oxygen starvation and the different ways it can happen. We might have euphoria or dizziness or a headache or cyanosis, blue fingernails. It kind of affects people differently.
Okay.
But any of those things could be symptoms that you feel. And eventually it will lead to you passing out. And that's no good when you're flying, because that could lead to an accident. Common causes of hypoxia would be high altitude flying without oxygen,
okay.
or a leak in the exhaust, if you're using exhaust cabin heating, which my aircraft has. And then alcohol and certain medications and stuff can also lead to hypoxia happening sooner.
Okay. What are the altitude oxygen requirements?
Well, if I am above 12,500 feet for 30 minutes, the pilots need oxygen, and then if I'm flying above 14,000 feet, we need oxygen continuously, and above 15,000 feet, the passengers need to have oxygen supplied to them. They don't have to use it. If they want to pass out, they can pass out.
Right. Let's say you're gonna jump into a new plane. It's turbocharged. It's got pressurized cabin, and your friend bought it. He's like, Caleb, you can fly this. And its service ceiling is 26,000 feet. Are you good to just hop in that plane and fly?
No, from a legal standpoint, I need a high-pressure endorsement, high-pressure flying endorsement, and then also from a just not feeling comfortable in the airplane, I'd want to fly with an instructor.
Sure, okay. So what's the cap for a high altitude?
It's 25, if it's certified or its max service ceiling is 25,000 feet, I believe. Max service ceiling is 25,000 feet, or it's one of two things is 25,000 feet, whichever is higher.
Sure. All right, so you understand that if you want to be flying that high, you need to get an endorsement, and you get that. Is that something you need to come to
you
me
get,
for?
It's just like tailwheel or high performance or complex. An instructor will fly with you. There are a little bit more requirements for they have to cover specific things, okay. Like high altitude depressurization emergency and stuff, and then they can sign you off in a logbook.
Perfect. What are some of the dangers of the atmosphere at above 20,000 feet? That's anywhere, but it gets exponentially worse above 20,000 feet.
It gets really, really cold, and it gets really, and you get really low air pressure.
Low air pressure. Okay. So we talk about things of useful consciousness. What would be an expected useful consciousness at 20,000 feet?
A couple minutes. Seconds,
okay.
Even.
What about at 35,000 feet?
Less than a minute.
Yeah. All right.
15 seconds.
Yes. Yeah. I think that's good. Around 15 seconds sounds good.
That's why I never take my 172 that high.
Yeah. All right. If you do, you'd want to bring oxygen. You mentioned cracks in exhaust leading to
hypoxia.
What's the term for the gas?
Carbon monoxide.
Okay. Let's say you think you have carbon monoxide poisoning. What's your action? Immediate action.
I'm going to declare an emergency. I'm going to descend. I'm going to turn off cabin heat, and I'm going to open my air vents. To blow the air through. The effects of carbon monoxide can linger for a long time, so my purpose for opening the air vents is to just blow out any carbon monoxide still in the cabin, but I'm expecting my delirious or euphoric or risk-taking senses or anything that came on from carbon monoxide poisoning to last for a little bit of time. I don't think it's just going to go away in a couple seconds, so I'm going to land as soon as possible and declare an emergency.
All right. How would you recover from a spin?
Well, if I'm in a spin, I'm going to immediately pull the power to idle. I'm going to apply opposite rudder correction with my ailerons held neutral. And once I've stopped the spinning with opposite rudder correction, so left spin, right rudder, vice versa, I am going to push the nose down to break the stall because I'm still in a stall. And then I'm going to pull the nose up slowly. Kind of a balance between don't overstress the airplane with G's and don't redline the airplane to VNE. So break the stall and pull up.
Is there an acronym that you can use to
I use the pair acronym.
Okay.
Power, aileron neutral, rudder opposite, elevator down then up.
Okay. So great. So we've talked about how to recover the airplane. What sort of mental checklists or written checklists are you gonna do to determine that you are good to fly?
Well, so I use the I'm safe checklist for myself. So I always check before every flight whether I have any illness, any medication.
I believe that you know it. So you use the I'm safe. What about for the airplane and?
So I use a bigger checklist that incorporates I'm safe called the PAVE checklist.
Okay.
So the P stands for the pilot. So that's me where I'm looking through. That's where I go through the I'm safe, and then the A is the aircraft, and that's where I'm going through. You know, pre-flighting it, making sure it has all its documents and everything, and in-opting any equipment that needs to be in-opted. And then V is the environment. That's a weather check. And then just what are the conditions like around me?
Okay.
And then E would be external factors. So that would be the pressure of the passenger or the dog in the airplane and that kind of stuff. Or the get there itis if I have a meeting or something.
Okay.
Those are the things I consider.
So we talk about with those external factors and even with internal factors, we talk about dangerous attitudes. Could you list to me the five dangerous attitudes?
Yeah. So there's invulnerability,
Okay. Macho,
anti-authority, impulsivity, and there's an R one.
Do you use an acronym for these as well?
Repulsivity.
You know it's an R, right?
Yeah, I know it's an R. I use an acronym called I'm Air because if you feel these things, you feel like you're air and you can float and you're never going to die. But the R would be, so I'm going to go through them again. So there's impulsiveness, there's macho, there's anti-authority, there is, I said impulsivity, invulnerability, and then there is
you ready to give up yet?
Yeah.
That was a hint.
Resignation. Yes.
All right, yeah, so understanding those hazardous attitudes, they can affect anybody at any time, even if you haven't had them before. Great. So now that you're a commercial pilot, I mean, good job. Everything so far has been really good. You'll be able to operate under different parts. So we want to make sure that we understand the law and understand the FAR aim as well, the FAR as well as we can. So what is Part 119?
Part 119 is the certification of different air operations. I almost said air carrier, but air carrier is one specific one. But
so then we might talk about Part 91. What's the basic?
Part 91 is just the general operating rules of the air.
Okay.
It kind of applies to everyone.
All right. What's Part 121?
Part 121 is air carrier operation, so airline operations. So they need to meet those, and then they'd be certified under Part 119 as a 121 operator.
What about Part 125?
125 is private carriage operations that are for larger aircraft. I think more than, I don't want to guess, but
okay.
I can look up the title. I think it says in the title what size the aircraft are.
All right. And would those be non-common carriage or non-common carriage?
That would be private carriage.
Non-common carriage. But what about 135?
135 would be common carriage, and it's air charter type operations.
Okay, so non-scheduled flights.
Yep.
All right. How do we define common carriage?
Common carriage is carriage that involves holding out.
Okay.
That's how I would define it.
Can you say that one more time?
It's carriage that involves holding out.
Okay. And that's it?
Yeah.
What if you're not transporting people or property?
If any carriage that's not private carriage.
All right. You're just being difficult. All right. All right. So, fine. We'll work with that. We're just going to go through our definitions here. What's holding out?
Holding out is a willingness to carry persons or property from place to place for compensation or hire.
Okay. Operational control we already talked about. Dry lease and wet lease we've talked about. So that works. Let's say your friend contacts you and he wants to do a charitable event. And... wants you to be the commercial pilot to fly the event, and it just starts getting hazy. He just keeps adding on things, and you're starting to really wonder, is this legal or not? Where can you go to figure out if it's legal or not?
Well, I would probably check. I mean, I don't want to be a rat, but you could go to the FISDO and just have them run it by. Well, I mean, I would go to the FISDO. I would say, hey FISDO, here's what we have, and does this look legal to you? I ain't no snitch, but there are also, I might also know some of the regulations, mm-hmm. so that can make it pretty cut or dry. I know in Part 61 there are clear regulations on charitable events, and you actually don't even need a commercial pilot's license to fly them.
Okay.
You just
that's good. All I wanted to hear is the FISDO.
Okay.
You go to the FISDO.
Going to the FISDO.
That's exactly the right answer I wanted to hear. All right. So to finish it off with where we should have started, what kind of medical do you have?
I have a first class medical.
Okay. What do you need to do commercial operations?
I need a second class medical.
Okay. Can you do commercial operations under basic med?
No.
Right, where would you find information about basic med? What FAR?
A couple different FARs. 68 and 61113I.
Okay. Where would you find information about what you need for first class, second class, or third class medical?
Part 6123 has that.
Outside of Part 61.
67. 67. That kind of 67 is where you might find what disqualifying diseases.
Sure. Yeah. So, what is specifically the difference between first, second, and third class? All right. Perfect. This was great. We've passed the oral portion. We'll move on now to the flying. Congratulations, Caleb. Now you get to show me how well you can do all this in the air.
All right.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching, guys. This is a commercial check ride, and we'll see you next time.
Yeah, let us know if you have a check ride coming up, or if you already took a commercial check ride in the comments below. We'd love to connect with you guys.
Fly safe.